thrilled to have the opportunity to welcome folks from Interpace, and in particular to introduce Dr. Alidad, and I know I'm going to butcher this, so I'm not even going to. It's a last name that's got a lot of consonants, and I'm just going to leave it at Dr. M, okay? Alidad is a population geneticist training, and has also gotten his MBA, and has had a career that has been in the world of science as well as in the world of Wall Street. He has an entrepreneurial spirit in having started a company and used a platform based out of the science laboratories at Yale for molecular diagnostics, and then joined the folks at Interpace in 2014 to head up their thyroid diagnostic program. And he's going to talk to us about that at this time and share what the science is behind this, and then open this up for questions. So, Alidad, welcome.
Yeah. So I'm here today to talk about molecular markers that can help risk stratify indeterminate thyroid nodules. I'm joined on the line with by one of our pathologists, VP of a pathology at our company, Christina Narick. At the end of the presentation, we're going to go through some case reviews, and I'm going to hand the presentation over to Tina at that point. But we're going to start talking about Thygenics and Thyromere. This is a dual platform thyroid testing offering that we've had in the market since 2014. But the core of the presentation will focus on the science behind these tests and covering some of the data we've generated to share with you. In this room, probably better than any room in this country at this point, the management of thyroid nodules is pretty well established. But if you look at it, it's become more holistic. It takes into account family history, radiation exposure, ultrasound technology has gotten a lot better over the past few years. Our ability to perform FNAs using ultrasound has gotten better, and then cytopathology, and finally molecular. So we at Interpace, while we value molecular, we don't think it's the only tool in the toolbox that you should use. And then we sort of, and as you see as part of our case reviews, we take a more holistic approach in looking at these nodules and trying to figure out what the best course of therapy is for these patients. As you know, thyroid nodules can result in indeterminate cytology in about 10 to 30% of the cases, depending on which institution you're talking about. And the challenge for companies like us is how to develop a single platform that can risk stratify Bethesda 3s that have only a 10 to 15% risk of malignancy, with Bethesda 4s and Bethesda 5s, which then increase the rate of malignancy probability to about 60 to 75. And just my opinion that regardless of what the claims are out there, a single platform has a very hard time ruling out cancer and ruling in cancer at the same time. And because of that, we decided that we won't use a single platform, and we're going to use a dual platform approach, a next-gen-based sequencing test that allows you to rule cancer in, and a microRNA-based classifier that allows us to rule cancer out effectively, giving our physician clients the ability to get both a high negative predictive value and a high positive predictive value result from a single FNA run. And that's what I'm going to talk to you about for the next few slides. I'm going to start with Thygenics. This is the first product we launched in the market. I believe it was in December of 2014. We just launched a expanded panel, which will be available in New York in the next few months. We are submitting our application to the state of New York soon. And once we get that, this expanded panel will be available in New York, but it's available in every other state in the United States. And we sort of really focused on adding markers that matter. There's a lot of thought that went into which markers should be added to this panel. We had options of adding hundreds of markers that have low, if any, correlation with malignancies or aggressiveness of thyroid cancer. And at the end, we decided to focus on markers that actually had high clinical value that's published and known. So just a quick background, some of the markers that you probably all have heard of, BRAF, RAS, RedPTC, You can find them in different kinds of thyroid cancer, but this room probably knows this slide better than I do, so I'm gonna skip it. The new panel called Thygenext has added 5 new mutations, ALK, GNAS, P10, RET, and TERT. Most of the additional markers that we added were RNA fusions that have a high level of correlation with cancer. They're not very common, but when you see them, you're pretty sure that that cancer is there. So I'm going to talk about some of these markers and go through the science of why we pick these markers and what role they play in our panel. So the first one is BRAF, which is a well-characterized marker seen in both aggressive thyroid cancers and PTCs. And it has the way it works, BRAF mutations have a negative correlation with outcome because this mutation prevents the cells from taking up iodine therapy. So patients who have a BRAF mutation are more likely than not to have a more aggressive form of cancer. And the presence of the BRAF mutation is a sure sign that that patient is a candidate for surgery. There's a lot of research done out of Hopkins by Dr. Jing. He's probably the most accomplished researcher when it comes to BRAF V600E. And his data is pretty clear that the presence of a mutation in the BRAF has a negative impact on survival. And some of his studies actually have gone out to 15 years looking at these patients. And in different kinds of thyroid cancer that show the mutation, you can see the yellow line is the BRAF wild type samples and the blue line is the BRAF mutated samples. And the same holds true when the thyroid becomes aggressive, it goes into the lymph nodes or it gets extra thyroid extensions. The role of the BRAF is magnified in these more aggressive forms of cancer. So BRAF is a very important marker, and it's definitely part of our panel as you look at it. There was another study done by Dr. Jing, and he looked at a cohort of patients over 15 years that looked at the mutation in BRAF in combination with the mutation in the TERT gene. And I've been attending the past few ATA meetings, and TERT has sort of been the bell of the ball. It's been a lot of research and talks about TERT. And when TERT is present in combination with BRAF, the prognosis for these patients become much, much worse than otherwise. And as you can tell, the red line here is the line that shows patients who have both mutations. And you can see the survival rate is much lower than either no mutation, BRAF only mutation, TERT only mutation, and those are the blue, green, and the black lines. So the other markers that we've added to our Thygenics panel include RET, which is a marker of medullary thyroid cancer. It's not a very common cancer, but at least having the RET mutation in there gives us the ability to diagnose it. Medullary thyroid cancer represents about 3 to 5% of all cancers, but 80% of these patients have distant metastases at diagnosis. So it's important to have a marker that differentiates medullary cancer from other kinds of thyroid cancer. And now this is part of our panel going forward. And finally, the TERT and the ALK mutations. I briefly talked about the TERT mutation. And ALK is another marker of aggressiveness. So I think when you put a panel out there for physicians to use, it's important to have some markers of aggressiveness in addition to markers that diagnose cancer. And I think TERT, ALK, and BRAF accomplish that goal for us and really are indicative of potential cases that have higher rates of recurrence. They have post-treatment reoccurrence. And they have a higher likelihood of the cancer spreading if you have markers such as ALK or TERT in the samples you get. So that's why we picked these kinds of markers to add to our next generation sequencing panel. And as you can see, this is Dr. Tuttle's diagram from the ATA guidelines from 2015. I want to thank him for putting this together. He's outlining the least aggressive to the most aggressive types of cancer from the bottom to the top of that arrow. And if you superimpose the kind of mutations that play a role in cancer, you can see high correlation between the markers that cause aggressiveness at the top of this list versus some of the other markers that are sort of lower in aggressiveness and connection to thyroid cancer at the bottom. So that was a brief overview of our mutational panel. I told you we have two separate platforms that we use to identify thyroid cancers. We use a microRNA panel that looks at 10 proprietary microRNAs, and I'll explain to you what microRNAs are, and for those of you who are not basic scientists, in a second. MicroRNAs are a cluster of small molecules, 20 to 23 base pair long, that are non-coding in nature, but they can stop the process of translating messenger RNA into proteins at a cellular level. Because of that, they can control cell functions with great effectiveness, and changes in the expression levels of these microRNAs have been correlated and demonstrated to play a role in uncontrolled cell growth or cancer as we know it. Research on these molecules has been pretty robust. We just went to Medline and we pulled some of this data out for this presentation. Since 2005, there have been at least 627 papers that have been written by independent groups on the role of microRNAs in thyroid cancer. And I know it's hard to see the table to the left of this slide, but here are some publications that have mentioned specific microRNAs that are part of our classifier. So I think this is a better way. So we actually looked at markers that not only diagnosed cancer, but that were useful and informative in different subtypes of thyroid cancer. And it was important for us to have a panel that worked across the different types of thyroid cancer, so it wouldn't be just restricted to one kind. And as you can tell, the ones that are highlighted in red are upregulated in thyroid cancer, and the ones that are highlighted in green are downregulated in thyroid cancer. So this research resulted in a paper that came out in 2016. As far as the design features of this classifier goes, we looked at variable cellular content in FNAs that can interfere with microRNAs, and we excluded the microRNAs that were prone to interference. We excluded those that had autoimmune inflammatory responses. We excluded those that gave us a signal in the presence of blood. We started with about 131 target microRNAs when this project started, and we ended up with 10 in the final algorithm. And the way we do this test is we run a real-time PCR assay. We measure the level of expression, and we plug it into an algorithm that spits out a number between 0 and 1. We have a cutoff. If the algorithm number is above that cutoff, that sample is designated as malignant. And if it's below the cutoff, we call that a sample benign. And we have copies of all these papers we can give you if you're interested in reading them. So the way our testing algorithm works is when samples, we actually do the testing only on indeterminate samples, which is Bethesda 3, 4, or 5s. There's really no need for molecular testing on Bethesda 2s and Bethesda 6s. They're either clearly benign or clearly malignant. So when samples come in, we do an extraction, and the first thing we do is we run the next-gen sequencing panel on these samples. If we get a BRAF-like mutation or a red PTC, which are strong drivers of malignancy, we stop and we report the results out to the physician. If we see no mutations, or we see a weak driver of mutation such as a RAS mutation, we then reflex the test over to our microRNA panel. And, you know, I like to use the analogy, the next gen sequencing panel is like an X-ray. It'll show you the fracture of the bone, but it doesn't give you any information about soft tissue damage around it. That's where the classifier comes in. It gives you a view into the cell biology at the time of the biopsy. And it allows you to get two looks at the sample that you're testing. So then we'll show you some samples, some cases in a second when Tina joins us, where the combination will highlight if a patient is truly benign or malignant. So in about 2015, 2016, we did a multi-center double-blinded study. We ended up with 109 indeterminate samples that were collected sequentially. These were the 109 that had actual surgical outcomes associated with them. And we compared the results of the molecular call with the final histopathology report for these patients. And it was published in JCENM as part of this paper. The test showed a pretty robust sensitivity of 89% and specificity of 85%, translating into a negative predictive value of 94% and a positive predictive value of 74%. And the conclusion was that this multi-platform testing paradigm can accurately classify benign and malignant thyroid nodules with both high MPV and high PPV. So I told you about the launch of an updated, more robust NGS panel, which we call Thygenics. We actually did a bridge study between the two different, the older version and the newer version, and we saw 100% concordance between the two. That was fully expected because every marker that's in the newer version is also part of the original version. There were a handful of samples where we saw new mutations, but all of those had a BRAF mutation in them anyway. So we see 100% correlation between the two samples. So for those folks in the New York market, don't be too upset that you don't have access to the expanded panel yet. The performance of the assay shouldn't really change that much. And then we looked at the prevalence. You know, PPV is highly driven by prevalence, and we looked at the prevalence of, I'm sorry, we looked at the performance of our assay in different prevalences, and we saw that we did outperform some of our competitors at any given prevalence. And here's a slide just showing you some of the additional data we've published as far as posters and in some of the scientific meetings that are focused on the thyroid on thyroid in the past few years. And we have copies of these available. If you have any questions or are interested in seeing them, reach out to me after the presentation. I'd be more than happy to provide those for you. So with that, I'm going to stop. Tina Narick is our VP of Pathology. I believe Dr. Narick is on the line. She's going to review a handful of cases where molecular testing really helped us at the risk of indeterminate thyroid nodule cytology cases.
What happens in terms of the algorithm to incorporate thyromere in the process here?
So every sample that comes to our lab is first tested with the next-gen sequencing panel, which is Thygenics.
Can you review the cytology as well?
We can. That's an option. So you can either do your cytology at your site or ask us to do it for you. And we don't do the cytology reads ourselves. We send it to an independent third-party lab, and we get the results back, and we communicate it back to the site.
So when we run Thygenics, there's really three outcomes that we see.
One is the presence of a strong driver mutation, like a BRAF. At that point, we stop and we say, this patient is a candidate for surgery, highly likely that it's a malignancy. At the other extreme, we find absolutely no mutations or no RNA fusions.
We don't believe the absence of mutations means there's no cancer.
For that to be true, every cancer would have to be caused by mutations, and every mutation that would cause cancer would be null. I don't think either one of those conditions is actually correct. So when we find no mutations, we reflex over to the microRNA assay. And only if both the Thygenics and the Thyromere platforms come up with a negative result do we call that patient low risk or no malignancy. There's a third option, which is we find a mutation, but that mutation is a weak driver of oncogenesis. The RAS family of genes is a perfect example of that. So if we find an HRAS or a KRAS mutation, you know, the literature thinks in about 60 to 70% of the cases, RAS mutations result in malignancy. So is that enough to just send someone to surgery? We don't think so. That's why we reflex over to the microRNA assay at that point to make sure that that RAS positive is actually mutant or not based on the classifier. So that's how our testing algorithm works.
I noticed among the mutations that you that are part of Thygenics, I didn't see Dicer, which is, as you know, a rare mutation in thyroid cancer, as you point out. But it is the enzyme that produces microRNAs, if I'm not mistaken. So wouldn't it be prudent to try to test for that?
We actually looked at a whole host of potential I think you're talking about this slide. This slide here. So when we went through the process of selecting the markers, we actually hired outside consultants and experts who looked at the literature, who looked at the frequency of a mutation. And we wanted to really focus on our mission, which was markers that matter. We purposely didn't include a lot of mutations that we thought either didn't have a lot of clinical evidence behind them, or they were really rare, or they caused, you know, false positive results. We can do that because we have this micro RNA classifier as a backup. So we don't have sort of a gun to our head to get the most expansive panel possible onto the market. Because if you're a company with only a one platform test, then that's the approach you're sort of locking yourself into. And because of that, we decided to stay somewhat limited in the number of mutations we added to this panel and allow the microRNA classifier to sort of be the safety net underneath it. Okay. So Tina, we got you. You can start covering case number one, and I'll change the slides.
Okay. Okay, sure. Thank you. Okay. So I'm the associate medical director at the laboratory, and so first, you know, I just really want to thank Dr. Erkin for inviting us to speak today so that we can share this information. My training's in cytopathology, so thyroid cytology is near and dear to me, but it definitely has its limitations, like I'm sure you're all well aware. So what I want to do is just briefly cover a few case scenarios. Then these are real patient cases that demonstrate how our analysis can be used by you all as clinicians and positively impact patient care. So the first case is a 51-year-old male with an isthmus nodule, and he has no prior history of thyroid disorder. His comorbidities are hypertension and hyperlipidemia. His mom had thyroid surgery. There's been no prior head and neck radiation to him. And on physical exam, they describe a prominent thyroid gland, just some right-sided fullness, no real distinct nodule, no cervical lymphadenopathy. He's essentially euthyroid. And on ultrasound, they identify this 1.6-centimeter isthmus nodule on the right. It's solid, hypoechoic, and heterogeneous, and has smooth borders, no calcifications, no cervical lymphadenopathy. So they aspirate this nodule, and the cytology diagnosis is AUS, which is the Bethesda 3 category. So next slide. So this aspirate then is subjected to molecular analysis, and what we find when we do our dual platform, on the next-gen sequencing panel, we identify an NRAS point mutation at 35% variant. And like, I just want to pause here and reiterate what Alidad has already described, where we now know that just RAS mutation positivity is sometimes erroneously equated to malignancy, but that is in error. And we all know that this is not true, and these can be identified in benign lesions. So the additional testing that we're able to do is a microRNA analysis. And in this case, the microRNA analysis yields a negative result. So our risk assessment, whenever we combine the two, is we identify this as a low to moderate risk. We're not willing to just, you know, toss out the RAS mutation as being completely insignificant. But at the same time, the thyromere gives us some reassurance that this is a lower risk, and this can be treated accordingly. So we talk about some suggested management in our reports, and we know that you as clinicians have a whole lot more information, and you're going to make your decision based on sonographic features and patient preference and clinical history and a lot, you know, a lot of other information than what we have to look at. But in this case, with a RAS mutation and a negative thyromere, we would say it's low to moderate risk. So in this case, this clinician decided to go ahead and operate, and the final diagnosis was a benign lesion. It was a follicular adenoma. So, you know, this is pretty common where you can identify RAS mutations in these benign lesions. So now to move on to case two, which is very similar, but a little bit different. This is a 75, this is the next slide then, Alidad. This is a 75-year-old male with a right-sided nodule, and he's healthy, no prior history of thyroid disease, no family history. He's euthyroid. On physical exam, there's an asymmetric thyroid goiter it's rubbery and movable, and there's no cervical lymphadenopathy. And then on imaging, they identify a large dominant right nodule, 4.2 centimeters, so it's pretty big, and solid hypoechoic heterogeneous with smooth borders, no calcifications. And then there's also a 2.5 centimeter left mid nodule. And so the cytology in this case is follicular lesion of undetermined significance. And I have to apologize, that actually is supposed to be Bethesda 3. But this cytopathologist, they go into some detail, as I'm sure you guys see commonly, where they're describing these follicular cells and some features that are worrisome to them. But he also talks about a moderate amount of caulate. And to us as cytopathologists, that's kind of, that's a good thing, and that makes you lean more toward benign. So in this case, he kind of is, you know, sitting on the fence and diagnosing this as a Bethesda 3, because he doesn't have enough to push it up higher, and he's seeing this colloid. Okay, so next slide. So when we do our panel, we identify a RAS mutation, just like we did in the last case. But in this case, our thyromere status is positive. And so we have a strong positivity here. And we know that this RAS mutation in and of itself doesn't indicate malignancy. But when you layer this microRNA analysis on top of that, we now are bumping up the overall risk assessment of this nodule to moderate to high. And so in that case, some management options that we, you know, would say could be suitable on our recording would be a total thyroidectomy or lobectomy. And no matter how you look at it, like, this lesion probably needs to come out. And so the clinician did proceed and do a total thyroidectomy, and they also took a few lymph nodes. And in this case, this ended up being a follicular carcinoma that extended to the margin, and there were 5 benign lymph nodes. So these two cases, I think, are a nice illustration of the impact of the microRNA analysis. They're both B3 cases. They're both RAS mutated. But then when you characterize it based on the microRNA analysis, you really do get some additional information and some insight as to the risk of malignancy. Okay, so moving on to case 3. This is a 49-year-old female with an isthmus nodule. She's had it for 5 to 6 years, euthyroid. Her mom and sister both had thyroid nodules, and she's had no previous neck radiation. And she actually had this previously biopsied, and it was benign. And she's euthyroid. On physical exam, they find this large palpable nodule that actually, as ultrasound indicates, it was 4.1 centimeters, sharply marginated, has vascularity, and it had previously measured 3.6 centimeters. So it's growing. So they're kind of concerned because it's growing and changing. When they aspirate it and do cytology, in this case, it's a Bethesda 4 category. So it's a little bit bumped up from the Bethesda 3 category. And they say that there's no features of papillary thyroid carcinoma present. So in this case, when we perform this analysis, we end up flat out negative on the next gen sequencing panel and thyromere as well. And this was interesting. So our risk assessment is low based on this analysis. And when we're looking through the chart on this patient, we saw that actually based on our analysis, the cytologist issued an amended report. And although he had originally diagnosed it as Bethesda 4, he now is saying this is probable benign thyroid nodule Bethesda 2. Thygenic oncogene panel shows no mutations. Thyromere microRNA is negative. And regardless, they went ahead and did a left thyroidectomy. And, you know, we don't know what that decision was driven by. It may have been patient preference. There may have been other features that dictated it. It was a big nodule, that's for sure. So the surgical pathology comes back, and the final diagnosis is follicular adenoma with no evidence of malignancy. So, you know, in some cases, this can help to avoid unnecessary surgery. There may have been other features that had driven this decision that we're not aware of. But, you know, certainly that can happen. But there's some cases where even in a Bethesda 4 category, unnecessary surgery can be avoided. Okay, so moving on then, next slide is case number 4. And this is a 76-year-old left or 76-year-old male with a left thyroid nodule. And this this patient actually has some kind of significant comorbidities. He had a history of prostate cancer. He has coronary artery disease, hypertension. He presents with throat irritation. His daughter had a thyroidectomy with a history of papillary thyroid carcinoma. He also has a pacemaker and some stents. So this is a guy that is probably not such a great surgical candidate. On physical exam, he has a soft palpable left-sided nodule, but there's tracheal deviation to the right due to this mass. On ultrasound, it's 2.8 centimeter left thyroid nodule with calcifications, and there's also noted to be a 1.3 centimeter level 4 nodule that they believe is a lymph node. So the mass itself is compressing and displacing the trachea to the right. So when they do the cytology diagnosis, it ends up being just a Bethesda 4. It's not even like, you know, suspicious for malignancy, although they've got an awful lot of features that would lead them to think that it is a malignancy. So it's subjected to our molecular analysis, and we identify a BRAF V600E mutation, which, as Alidad had previously described, and you all are familiar with, it's a pretty ominous and strong indicator of malignancy. So as he said, in our flow, we don't actually need thyromere analysis in cases where you have a BRAF positive finding, but in this case, we actually had thyromere done, and it was strongly positive, which is consistent with what we already knew. But so the risk assessment overall in this case would be high, and they took out his thyroid, and they also did a central lymph node dissection. So they were able to, you know, assess this up front, and I think that it helped to guide their management in terms of approaching it with a lymph node dissection. And then on surgical pathology, it came back as papillary thyroid carcinoma, follicular variant. The margins were positive, and also there was some extra thyroid extension. And then there was the one lymph node that was positive and two benign lymph nodes. So you know, overall, I think that these cases kind of demonstrate the value of the information that's provided by the combination testing platform and how it could benefit you and your patients. So anyway, I'm sorry that I wasn't able to, you know, make the audio connection initially, but I'll turn this back to Dr. Mireskandari, and he can wrap up with the summary.
So just in summary, we think thyrogenics and thyromere, by virtue of having both high MPV and high PPV, can reduce the number of surgeries on benign cases. We do mutational analysis based on not just markers that are diagnostic, but also prognostic to help you understand or better define the risk of progression for these patients. We haven't really talked about sample collection, but our assay is very simple and convenient. We can accept either fresh biopsy FNA samples in the FDA food buffer or cytology slides. No cold storage, no refrigeration, no ice packs are necessary. The buffer that we use is FDA approved to keep nucleic acids stable for up to 6 weeks at room temperature. So you can just send the samples back to us via FedEx without any kind of special handling. We do offer unbiased professional cytology services through a third-party lab. So if that's of interest, that's an option for those on the call. I did talk about no special shipping or handling requirements. We do offer a comprehensive test result report, as Tina just showed you. Our pathologists actually review every single case and take into account more than just molecular results to give a final report to the referring physician. We use a sort of a, what I call an old school phenol extraction method in our lab. So our QNS rates are very low, less than 5%. So that's a badge of honor for our lab people. I think we're very proud of that. And our test is covered by Medicare and many of the major managed care companies. And Greg is in the room. If you have any questions about that, you can catch him on the way out. And we do have a patient assistance program as well for those who need assistance to pay for some of this testing. So with that, I'm going to stop and open the call and the meeting to Q&A. If anybody has any questions, I'll be more than happy to answer.
So I have a certain skepticism in regards to the positive predictive value with the inclusion of Bethesda 5, and that's just because usually in the hands of experienced psychopathologists, a Bethesda 5 would probably yield upwards of 80% in regards to the likelihood that it's a carcinoma. That being said, there's been disparity of inclusion or exclusion of Bethesda 5 in studies for molecular analysis. And that's across the board with any molecular or genetic study. It's not exclusive to hygienics or biomarker. So we would probably be reflexing out more so the Bethesda 3 and 4, at which the positive predictive value may vary a little bit. What would be interesting in the realm of research would probably be the value of the addition of thyromere to the gene panel for NIFD. So the NIFD category that, you know, basically changed our paradigm of diagnosis of thyroid carcinoma is now making us all kind of reevaluate, you know, how are these molecular tests going to pan out to detect those. And none have really been able to give us those answers. And I think it's probably early to tell, but I think that it might be valuable in the realms of research to see how this may help us in that regard.
That's an excellent comment.
And we do have a multicellular clinical study underway, predominantly with sites in New York. And some of the questions you just raised are part of the protocol that we're trying to answer. So stay tuned. My comment on.
So what we do is we have high-powered microscopes and cameras, so we first take a high-resolution picture of the slide to keep a copy of it. And depending on how much our cytologists see, we try to do microdissections. For Bethesda 3s, we pretty much have to do a whole slide extraction. But you know, for Bethesda 5, where you can clearly see spots on the slide that look different, that look suspicious, that look interesting, our cytologists just do a micro dissection for those. Because our panel, just not to get too deep into the weeds here, but our NGS panel has a PCR step involved. So because of that, we can start with very little material. As long as the QFI on that sample is good and the quality of the sample is good and the data is not chopped up too much, we can get a signal of that. And we actually presented a poster, I believe it was 2016 ATA, when we looked at the non-diagnostic slides, we took about 100 and something of those slides, and we were able to perform our NGS test on about 69% of those. So we have good success there.
Thank you for your presentation. I have two questions. Is this a dynamic process for you as a company to continually get feedback on the final results of your testing to determine and to continue to modify the accuracy of your of what you're reporting? Why don't you start with that?
So that's an excellent question. We actually, about a year ago, started our own thyroid registry. So we look at all the samples that come through the door for commercial purposes. And we've contacted some of the referring physicians and some of the referring sites. And we look at the outcome for these patients. And we try to track that outcome. To see, for example, if we made a call that a patient is benign, what's the warranty on that call? Going out 6 months, a year, 18 months later. So that registry has been gathering information from the sites and collecting patient reports for the past year, and we'll continue to populate that registry for the foreseeable future, because I think the question you asked is a very important one. That we need to show that our calls, both on the benign side and on the malignant side, actually matter in the way the patient is treated and the care the patient receives. So yes, that's definitely something that we've spent a lot of time and effort in managing. And we're constantly going through our data. We did, you know, almost 10,000 thyroid tests last year. So we have a freezer full of samples and terabytes worth of data that we're constantly going through to look to see if there's a better way of analyzing the test. We just hired we just signed a contract with a bioinformatics group at a very prestigious university to help us update our Thyromere classifier using machine learning processes. So we're constantly trying to upgrade our testing abilities and do a better job than we did previously.
Second, do you have a question, Martin?
Yeah, so I want to ask you, in correlating your FNA outcomes with a pathology, do you have any proof that you've gone back and actually tested the tumors and compared the tumor results with the FNA results?
So yeah, that was the paper we showed you, that's exactly what they did. This paper here. So that's exactly what they did. They made the molecular call blinded to the results of the histopathology reports, and then an independent analysis of the histology reports was compared to the molecular ones.
No, but and then do you do the molecular
pathology? On the FFPEs?
Yes.
We haven't done that. We're going to do that for this. Okay. So the study we have going on now, we'll be doing that as well. So that's part of the study protocol. So it wasn't done for this paper. But that's a very interesting question. So we're going to do that. Maybe not for all the samples in the study, but we'll take a representative set and we'll do the molecular on the FNA. We'll compare it to the histopathology report, and then we'll take some of those FFPEs and rerun them. FFPEs are interesting sample set because it's more concentrated. You get an amplified signal.
The microRNAs are well preserved.
Correct.
So do you
It becomes a chicken and egg thing because you need surgery done to get the FFPE cuts, right? And we try to avoid surgeries that are unnecessary. So we are doing another study in FFPEs that looks at the aggressiveness. So we've found a different signature, molecular signature that I haven't talked about here, mm-hmm. that looks at potential aggressiveness, but that's a different kind of study that we have ongoing right now.
So in the session that you that preceded this, where we're constantly trying to make decisions about patients who have already undergone treatment or about to undergo treatment, the folks who have undergone treatment, and we've got, and Mark, this dovetails into Margie's question, is it commercially available for us to send specimens to you for further analysis to help us to prognosticate and about treatment and downstream follow-up?
So if you're looking for a BRAF or a TERT signal, yes, that's available right now for both New York-based physicians and anybody else. But we're working on a dedicated panel to look at that question specifically, and that's not ready yet. It's still in development stage. And I've talked about, but that's probably something that will be available in early 2019. It'll be dedicated to look at the aggressiveness of the cancer as opposed to having more diagnostic properties. Yes, it's definitely one of our top development priorities at the company, is to make that option available, especially to the surgeons. Who need to know if you're going into a thyroid that has a signature that's going to predict anaplastic or poorly differentiated outcomes versus an indolent PTC.
Is it known how variable microRNA expression is throughout a single lesion? Various areas may express more.
Well, there are some microRNAs that are specific to tissue type. As I said before. We ended up with 10. We started with 131, we went through a very rigorous process of eliminating microRNAs that were not specific to thyroid, or they were differentially expressed in the presence of blood or not. So we got rid of a lot of the targets that we started with based on how they behaved under different conditions. And we tried to come up with a panel that was pretty consistent in being predictive of malignancy by being upregulated or downregulated in thyroid tissues.
Could you you. I know we're all on a little bit of a short time schedule here, but do you have any, could you just share with us any information you have comparing this panel to other commercially available panels in terms of vetting indeterminate nodules?
I actually had a slide. I wasn't going to go there, but since you asked. I think I have it. Yeah. So we've actually, by being a commercially oriented company, we look at what our competition does and what claims they make, and we have a comparison list on the screen here that looks at the performance of our assay, and the performances are what the companies themselves have put out there. So we're not editorializing in any way the numbers that you see on the screen here. Veracyte that offered the Firmatest just launched their sort of second generation product called the Firma GSC. And you can see that in the middle column there, and ThyroSeq V3, which is Dr. Nikki Farov's product, is in the right-hand side column. Area that we think we outperform them is the rate of benign calls. This is what I call the benign yield. It's one thing to have a negative predictive value, but you need to have a high negative predictive value and a high benign yield. Otherwise, you're categorizing a lot of benigns into the suspicious category. So as you can see, our benign call yield, because of the dual platform nature of our test, is just shy of 70% compared to 55% and 65% for Afirma and Veracyte. And as far as the performance numbers go, all the tests have pretty high negative predictive values, and those numbers are statistically probably indifferent if you want to be fair about it. And we have a pretty strong PPV. Again, that's partly due to the two-platform approach that we use, and partly by focusing on markers that matter and really incorporating markers that are highly diagnostic into our panel.
And just to Maria's point, is this comparing apples to apples in terms of percent of Category 5 specimens included in this analysis?
I got to go back and look to see if the Afirma paper included the Bethesda 5. I think they did, but I don't want to stand here and tell you for sure if they did or not. I know in our numbers the Bethesda 5s are included. But I can dig that up and get back to you.
I think that would be a really important piece.
Yeah. I know they were in the Alexander paper, which was the predecessor paper. And in all of the Afirma's presentation, they've said they've used the same sample set from that paper. So again, I would say they used it. They used the Bethesda 5s in their analysis, but I don't want to stand here and definitively make that claim.
So from a statistical perspective, shouldn't we know that we've got the same number of Bethesda 3-4 percentage-wise and Bethesda 5? In each
of these analyses? We can dig that out. I mean, that's easy to pull out of all the papers and reanalyze the data.
Yeah. Any other questions? Great. All right, thank you very much.